Welcome to a special edition of The Dirt. We are talking with Hall of Famers Bill Edwards and Scott Whitlock, and we're going to chat more on Title IX, gender equity, the 50th anniversary and celebration of Title IX as we approach that this summer, and a unique perspective. These two gentlemen have been in the game, we won't say how long, but a long time, and have done so much to grow the sport and have seen it through a couple different lenses on the field, as a parent, as an administrator, and I think we're going to get into some really good things. So, coaches, for those who don't know you or aren't as familiar with you, Bill, why don't you start us off? Tell us a little bit about how you got involved in softball and your coaching journey.
Well, I started back in about 1980 when I moved to the high school. I was a public school teacher for 33 years and started at the elementary school and then went to the junior high school for quite a bit. And then when I got to the high school, after coaching some freshman teams to the junior high school, I wanted to coach baseball because that's what I was coaching in the junior high school. But the position was taken by a legend. But the softball position was open. And I had been playing some slow pitch because men's fast pitch had died here on Long Island. And I said, yeah, I can do that. Let me give it a shot. So that's where it all started, about 1980 with a high school team. Stayed at the high school level for about 10 years. And then an opening happened at Hofstra in 1990. And I transitioned over to Hofstra. And that's where I really began to understand the game at a higher level and really enjoyed every minute of my experience coaching.
Thank you, Coach. Scott, how about you? What was your journey like?
I backed into it. I came from a very rural area in Georgia, and there were virtually no opportunities for young women to go play ball. I mean, I was aware we had a girls basketball team at our high school that I went to, but I never really gave it much thought or anything. But when I went to junior college, I needed to do something in terms of work study to help pay my way. And I just happened to take a job being a gopher and could keep stats or this, that, and the other for the women's basketball coach at Truett McConnell College up in Cleveland, Georgia. And it was at that time that I discovered the female athlete. And when I say the female athlete, I don't mean, oh, isn't that cute? The girls are out there playing ball and they're having fun and all this. No, I'm talking about serious athletes who work hard at their sport that just happen to be women. And I really, really, really was fascinated with it. And it was through my working, like I said, just as a grunt, that I was able to build rapport with female athletes. And I found out that I had a knack for communicating with them. So after my JUCO time was over with, I chose to go to Piedmont College, which is a very small school up in Northeast Georgia, to finish my college degree. And the women's basketball coach there had met me because he had come to Truett McConnell to do some recruiting, and he offered me a job as a student assistant. So I was a student assistant with the women's basketball team, and I was playing baseball. And so I discovered coaching that way. It was not something that I was out looking for, but it was something that when it found me that I developed a great passion for, became just a huge fan. And I was very blessed that shortly after graduating from Piedmont, there was a little school just north of Atlanta called Kennesaw College that was starting athletics, all athletics. And I got hired at Kennesaw College in 1985 by a great man who's gone now, Coach Speck Landrum. And originally I was the assistant women's basketball coach, head softball coach. And this was slow pitch softball. Down in the South, in the 80s, you didn't play fast pitch softball. High schools didn't play it. Nobody played it. And so that was how I got into it. And then we had Coach Landrum retired, a new athletic director came in, Dave Waples, and we made the decision to take softball kind of more on a national track. And he asked me, had I ever coached fast pitch softball? I said, no, I never have. I played baseball. I've never coached fast pitch softball. I don't even know if I like the sport. And he said, well, if you're going to stay here at Kennesaw, you're going to have to, because we're going fast pitch next season. And I remember I kind of cleared my throat and I looked at him and I said, I think fast pitch softball is the wave of the future. I don't know how we can't do it, that we've got to get involved in this, because I wanted to keep my job. And so I was very lucky. I had a year. So in between coaching the slow pitch softball that spring, I went and gobbled up as much fast pitch softball as I could and watched it. I remember driving down and watching Doug Palmer's teams down at the University of West Florida. Bob Heck's team over at Georgia State was already playing. So I gobbled up as much of it as I could. And I found out that I knew a lot about the fundamentals of fast pitch softball, but I didn't know that I knew it, because I didn't have a point of reference. And so when I kind of figured out that fast pitch softball is by and large, with a few changes, in my opinion, it's the game of baseball played inside a pinball machine. It's the angles are different. The, the game's faster. The game is got a lot of its own nuances. Obviously the pitching's different. Some of the approaches to hitting are different. But the ideas of hit, catch, run, throw are the same. And I knew I could teach those. And so that's kind of how I got into this business.
Sometimes it feels like a pinball machine. That's the truth, for sure. Well, guys, when you think about, the early stages, right? Bill, you mentioned 1980 high school program, your 8 years removed from Title IX, still hadn't reached a lot of areas yet. Scott, you talk about 85 and Kennesaw College. What were some of the first things about just Title IX? When you hear it, what do you think about? What memories do you have? What comes to mind when you think about it as an early coach? And then we'll do the question again, today. But what comes to mind, Bill, from, the early stages of your career?
Let me tell you a story about me walking out to my first softball practice. I'm walking out to my my first softball practice after coaching a year of football with the high school kids. I'm walking out to the field and three young ladies come up to me and they say, "We've heard about you." And they're all dressed in their softball practice uniform. And I sort of gave them the look and then they go, "We want you to coach us the way that you coached your football players." And I sat back then and I go, "I'm in the right spot." I said, "This is something very, very special to have my first real insight into women's athletics by three players." And two of those players went on to win a Division I national championship in field hockey. But it was an amazing experience for me. Being in a public school, we weren't lacking for anything. We had a wonderful facility. We had all the resources that we needed in order to play. And I don't know too much about what the discussions were back in, during that period of time with the administrators regarding Title IX. But I know that if I was lacking for anything, I would fight for my kids and I would make sure that my players and my kids would get whatever they needed to be successful. And so it'd be that things like that turned out. I mean, I really didn't lack for anything at the high school level. Now, whether or not it was because of Title IX, 8 years into Title IX, whether or not the administration was talking about it, whether or not, the athletic directors and the Board of Education were aware of it and were providing equal opportunity for both the males and the females. But since I was able to take care of my players and my kids and my team, and I could teach them and educate them and hopefully mentor them a little bit, I was in a pretty good position. And when those girls came up to me and told me how they wanted to be coached, I knew I was in a very powerful situation. That was a turning point for me.
What about you, Scott? What are some of the first things that you remember or think of?
Well, I always go back to the journey. I was very blessed that Kennesaw College had a female president, Dr. Betty Siegel, who was a visionary, who always had viewed men and women on the same plane in every arena, whether it's in the classroom, athletically, socially. So I never was having to do a lot of fighting and screaming to get my players something. What I had to do more than anything was convince my players to give me a shot at this, because I had to tell them, like I said, I'd coached slow pitch softball at Kennesaw for a few years, and we were like the Harlem Globetrotters of slow pitch softball. I mean, we beat everybody, and we beat them bad for the most part. But when I went to the team and told them that, you know, this was going to be the last year of slow pitch, I knew we had good athletes there, but also none of these athletes ever played fast pitch softball before. And I knew we were going to have to go out and recruit some position specific stuff. But I also knew that I was not going to turn my back on these young ladies who had college scholarships to play softball. So anybody that wanted to stay and play, we were going to let stay and play. And I thought I would be just maybe taking my medicine for a couple of years while I did that and honored the scholarship. But the athletes were so good that they made it they made the transition very well. But what I had to do was be honest and forthright with them and say, look, you've never played it. I've never coached it. So we don't know that we can't do it. You know what I mean? We don't know. We got to try this together. We're going to go on an adventure. And we signed two pitchers, one from Calgary, Alberta, Canada, one from Illinois. We signed a catcher, and we signed a third baseman. And those were the first four fast pitch players that we brought to campus. And we just worked through it together. And I was a very loud, demonstrative coach my entire career. But my whole program, was based on trust and faith and respect. They knew that I respected them. And it's kind of like what Coach just said. My players wanted to be coached like they were players. They did not want to be coached like they were female players. They were athletes who were females. And as long as you give them that dignity right out of the chute, and you tell them that you're not going to be perfect, that you're going to mess up with them, they'll buy it. And incidentally, that first team back in 91 went 41-11 and finished fourth in the NAIA World Series that year. I was blessed to have great athletes. I had a part-time assistant coach. He was tremendous. He could do the things that I couldn't do. And we got lucky on the recruiting in terms of evaluating and finding a couple of pitchers that could come in here in first strikes. And we took off. But it was all made easier because the athletic administration was in tune with the university's administration in that we're going to have athletics for men and women. And I know that people use the word women's basketball, men's basketball. I've always felt lucky that softball did not have a male companion, because I love just calling them softball players. I did not ever refer to my team as the Lady Owls. I mean, we were the Owl softball team. I can't stand Lady Owls. I mean, we were athletes. They were athletes that happened to be females, and I was a coach that happened to be a male. And we just kind of went along our way.
Well, I've heard that a lot from a lot of different guests on this topic, that administratively, it makes all the difference in the world. Like when you have the administrator, the athletic director, the president, whatever it might have been, and various institutions committed to the growth of your sport, that it completely changed your ability to have success as a coach. And, you know, Scott, I know you spent some time in administration, but did you find that to be true, you know, both of you throughout your entire coaching career when it came to having successful programs? Because both of you had extremely successful programs, you know, start to finish. How much of the role was the administrative side of that? Well, Scott, you want to go first?
Yeah, in my case, it was just organic because that's just the way it was at Kennesaw State. Like I said, Betty Siegel was the first female president in the University System of Georgia colleges. She knocked down the doors before I got there. And, you know, we knew when we went to work that that men and women are going to be looked upon as equals, that we were not going to give the baseball team 13 scholarships and give softball two. We're not going to go out and give men's basketball 15 scholarships and women's basketball six. It's not going to happen. I never, ever, ever coached a season with everything that I wanted, but I never went into a season without everything I needed. And I think that is a perspective that's a little bit, that we can talk about this a little bit later, that it's gotten skewed now. There's a difference between what you want and what you need to be successful. And you just gotta, I feel like, to particularly as college athletics is evolving right now, I feel like you've gotta be aware of what neighborhood you live in and maximize it. I use the house analogy. I don't live in a 36 room house, but I've got a 7 or 8 room house that's beautiful. And that's where I live. And I'm comfortable living there. So I don't try to compete with the people who own the 36 room houses. We can't. Programs like Hofstra and Kennesaw State, we had to be very much attuned to who we are. And sell everything and work everything from the standpoint of we've got enough to be successful. Now, if we didn't, we would talk about it. But I never could really, the only thing I ever really remember having to really scrap for was we had a temporary outfield fence when we originally built the softball field at Kennesaw State. And I wanted a permanent fence, but because they were also teaching phys ed on this big field, my outfield sometimes was part of a soccer field. So I remember just I had to keep scratching at, wanting to, you know, to put up the permanent outfield fence. And once I did that, you know, that may be the last time I ever had to really campaign for something for our team.
Bill, how about you? What was your experience with administration?
You know, it's funny because I left the public school and got to Hofstra, and I immediately went to the equipment room to find out what equipment I had to start my program with. And I had a broken pitching machine. I had 6 bats and a bucket of balls, and that was it. And I said, okay, where's the field? So I go out to the field, and there's a phys ed class on my field. And then I found out that the lacrosse team comes out after that, and the men's lacrosse team practices on the field. So I don't know, again, you know, here we are in the 1990s. And to me, the 1990s is where the growth of women's athletics really exploded. The administration at Hofstra promised me that within a certain period of time, we were going to go from 1.5 scholarships, we were going to increase them and become a fully funded program, that they were going to skin the grass off of the intramural field and start making it a softball facility, that they were going to put up a temporary fence, that we weren't have to bring the benches out from the locker room for the dugout, that I would be able to gradually increase the resources over a period of time. Now, again, I don't know. I wish it was a fly in the wall to figure out whether or not that was part of Title IX, because Hofstra is very much aware of everything that's going on in the legal system, whether or not it was just, we had a tremendous president at the time who was growing athletics within the university. So I think between the combination of Title IX and a very incredible president who was growing the entire athletic program. 10 years later, through the step after step and resource after resources, we had a stadium that would seat 1,000 people. We hosted regionals. We had corporate sponsors that were sponsoring us at the time. We were fully funded. We had pretty much everything that we needed in order to be successful. We could get on an airplane and fly down and maybe play at Kennesaw State. So it was a transition of 10 years, a little bit at a time. Again, getting what you need rather than what you want, piecing the puzzle together so that you have an opportunity to be successful. And again, trying to teach your players, your women, to fight for the things that they have to fight for, to make sure that, you know, they're not intimidated by anyone. And again, to you know, put together a program that makes sense to the people so that you're able to be successful. And I, you know, from the 96 Olympics, okay, and I keep bringing that up, we talk about women's soccer, women's softball, women's basketball, and gymnastics, all team-oriented sports. And I sit back and think about all the little girls that might have been watching the Olympics during that period of time and realizing, you know, I do have a chance to play. I do have a chance to participate. And then with Title IX acting as a catalyst of the whole thing, and with your administrators being cognizant of the fact that if they're not going to do it, that there's going to be consequences brought about because of Title IX, I think we're in a pretty good situation.
I was fortunate to avoid that. Bill, did they skin the field for you?
Finally, yep, they sure did.
Well, see, that makes me mad because I had to skin my own. We did. My assistant coach, Don McKinley, and I don't know if you ever met Donnie. He was with me for the first 13 years. We went out there on a Saturday morning. We went up to plant operations. We got the little tractor with the blade on it. We had chalked out the infield. And he and I, skint that infield and hauled it off one weekend. And I'll never forget the head of the physical education department at Kennesaw State came to work that Monday, and part of his soccer field was now dirt. And he came down and asked my AD what happened out there. And I think the only answer he gave was Scott and Don. And so he immediately bucked it to us. And so I spent the next 3 or 4 years trying to convince him. He's a very nice guy. He's the president now of the university, so I'm not going to embarrass him. But that, no, you play fast pitch softball on dirt. You don't play it on grass. And but yeah, that was something. You brought back a great memory then, because we just kind of went in and did it one day.
I let them skin it, but I made sure that I would rake it, water it.
Oh yeah.
You know, all the special things to make it just the way we wanted it to be.
Oh yeah, we were the original ground crew here too. There's a lot of things that these young coaches don't know that we did.
Well, and then you also have coaches that are still doing it, right? I mean, I was at a Division I game not too long ago. Doubleheader coaches are doing the field between games.
Yeah,
that's and you're still going, out there. You know, that's a little hard right now. You got all these things to do, and so the involvement of some of it is lacking in definitely some places.
Well, I'm happy to say at Kennesaw State now they have grounds people who take care of the field. They got that a couple of years before I retired.
We also wanted our players to have ownership of our field. So
absolutely.
We would give them the rakes. We would give them the tampers. We would give them the clay. We would make them rake the dirt off of the grass. We would make them clean up, you know, everything so that it was their house. It was their home. It was something that they needed to take ownership of in order to become proud of.
Yeah. I remember, Bill, one time I had to almost break up a fight in the middle of the game because my left fielder became angry that whoever we were playing that day, they were spitting the sunflower seeds out onto the field. And her job was to take care of the third base dugout. And she knew that she was going to have to go somehow and get those up. And she was going to go. She started over there to tell them to quit doing it. And I said, no, we'll handle it another way. Don't do that.
Oh, well, now I know that you have seen, you know, quite the change from, we talked about the initial stadiums. You look around the country and what you see now in the growth of softball and the way that it looks, you know, in both of your areas geographically, and some things that are just probably really surprising. But then we also hear stories about how, you know, when Joan Joyce was throwing, it was, you were getting 3,000-4,000 people then. Like that having a lot of people at a softball game isn't maybe a new thing, but sometimes it feels like it is. So when you think about the growth from the fan base and having the people there, what are your thoughts? Why have we achieved so much, and where do you think we still have room to grow and get better with that? Bill, you want to go first?
I just think that social media has done so much for it. TV, ESPN, the coverage. I remember going to our first 6 or 7 regionals, nothing was on TV. And then all of a sudden we're on TV. So any exposure that you get through, you know, whether it's a streaming service or a social media or, you know, national television, we're just seeing the game explode, because the more people are inclined to see something, the more interested they become. And the more interested they become in our game, certainly, they'll watch a softball game now probably more than they're going to watch a baseball game, because of the excitement, because of the speed. The talent now of our players is ridiculous. And it's just great to see. You know, I was at a Hofstra doubleheader this weekend, and in the stands were 12 alums, and we sat around and the stands were filling up, and people, beautiful day in the afternoon, they had, you know, something to do, and they would just come down to watch a softball game, 1.5 hour, 2 hours. They could stay for one game or two games, and the game is exciting. The talent is good. It's just something that has transcended from the Joni Joyce time with the Rebestos Briquettes and the 4,000 people in stands and the world tournaments and the national tournaments. And I think that's something that's missing in our game today, is going back and having the current players understand why they are where they are or how they got there. You know, baseball does a great job with the legacies and the history and everything that is important to the game. And I think we have to do a better job of educating the people on the Margie Wrights and the Linda Wells and the Gail Blevins and the Donald O'Pianos and all the people that played the game back in the day for fun. And then when Title IX and things started to transpire a little bit, they were able to get into the coaching aspect of it. And now when you look down at the trickle down affair of everything that's going on with our game and the women that have played our game, that have stayed in our game, I'm seeing more travel ball coaches, college coaches. If you take the Tennessee, Texas A&M game that was played last night and think of all the players that are in the dugouts, think of the support staff, how many females were on that support staff to get them there, the coaches that are there, the assistant coaches, the trainers, the strength coaches, the sports marketers, the compliance people. It's unbelievable at how far we have come because of the Joni Joyces, because of the Gail Blevins, because of the Margie Wrights, because of people there that played the game for the right reasons and then have passed it on to the current generation. And now with social media and television and the exposure, It's in a great place, but it has to be monitored. It has to be taken care of.
Scott, how about you? What are your thoughts on the growth and the next stages of growth?
Well, before I get on that, I want to share, I know it would be y'all's thoughts as well. It was very, very sad when we lost Coach Joyce. She was a national treasure. I used to kid her about the fact, how does it feel to know that one time you were the best at your given sport there ever was? I mean, there was a moment in time when she was the best player in the world in softball. And not only that, she was a women's professional golfer. And she would laugh about it, always understated, but she was a pioneer. And Coach Edwards is 100% correct when he says not enough attention is being paid to the history of our sport. I mean, everything that I've done as a coach, I've stood on the shoulders of female athletes. I mean, and female coaches, people who lost money doing it, not make a living doing it, who paid to go do it. I mean, the people of that era. Now, what caused the growth is a lot like what Bill said. I mean, thank goodness for the 96 Olympics. Thank goodness for television. Thank goodness for computers and that. And plus, thank goodness for the evolution of the coaches and the players. You see, the coaches had to take women's athletics seriously to let the game become what it was. I mean, again, as I talk about down in Georgia, it's because I went through the transition from slow pitch to fast pitch. Down here, so many people thought that slow pitch was enough, whatever that means. And I don't just mean males. I mean female. They thought that was enough. But I, the last time I checked, I've not seen a slow pitch softball game on ESPN on a Tuesday night. I just haven't done that. I mean, we had to evolve. And the female athlete obviously has evolved. They've evolved during my career. I mean, college softball used to be, you know, bunt, slap, steal, hope you get a pass ball and you win 1-0. You know, now you got to hit and play this game. And you got to build, but you know what, though? Even doing that, we're losing some of the nuances. When's the last time you've seen a game where both teams in the game were really good bunting or really good doing this or that? It's always a give or take during these evolutionary periods. And the teams that capture all that are the teams that seem to fare better. But the history, the evolution, the price that people paid before us, these young players, and more importantly, I'm going to say this, these young coaches need to know it. They need to embrace their history and not be intimidated by it. Or not care about. Apathy is a horrible thing when it comes to stuff like that. And you know, history, not just in softball or in athletics, but history is an ignored science now in society. It really is. And I think you can learn a lot about how you should proceed forward by looking back. And I mean, I love to spend time with older coaches. Now that I'm one of them, I don't enjoy it as much as I used to, but, you know, I'm surprised that me and Bill both have been able to make it this long without one of us having to leave the room for a moment. But we're doing fine now, aren't we, Bill?
That's the first thing you have to ask is where's that special room?
Yeah, where's the room at?
You guys are crushing it. You're crushing it. Well, that's been one of the really cool things about doing this is that, you know, we've had the conversations with Yvette Girard and Margie Wright and Judy Garman and Joanne Graff and so many people, you know, that we're trying to have the conversations with because we do have an absence of the history. And I was a history major and, you know, my first few bosses were, you know, Joanne Graff and D. Abrahamson, Donna Martin, and Margot Yonker. Like, I didn't have a choice. Like, I was going to learn. I was going to learn, and I was going to love it. And I did. It worked out really well for me, and I've cherished those days. But there are some people who, they just don't know what they don't know. I mean, they've been afforded so many opportunities because of Title IX and the growth that they don't even realize that there was such disparity. And that's a gift. That's a special gift that they don't even know that. But then we see the women's basketball video from a year ago and you're going, oh my gosh, how are we still here? You know, how are we still here where there's these huge differences and, you know, you can't get a seat to an Alabama softball game. They're turning their students away. Their baseball stadium's half empty because everything for softball in a lot of places just viewed as this like scaled down model. Our base paths are smaller, so everything else is smaller, you know, and I don't know, 90-foot bases don't have anything to do with second decks to me, but I guess that's a different story for a different day. But what do you think is important to celebrate? And then what do you think is important to put the gas pedal on of, you know, your fight's not done yet either, current generation? Like you still have some things to do here. Bill, what do you think of? What comes to mind?
You know, I think that we have to make the game. I'll look at a game, like I was looking at some games this weekend streaming, because I'm a junkie, so I'm all over the place. I have some of my players that are now, you know, coaching, and some of my coaches are now coaching, so I'm following them all over. And there's certain things within our game which I think we can make better. I think we can make the pitching rule better. I think we can change maybe some of the slap rules to make it better. I think we have to coach the game better. I think if there's one ball being hit to one person with one decision that has to be made, we're in pretty good shape because we're very talented as individuals. But are we missing the concept of when the ball is hit to one person and we have multiple decisions for that person to make? And the you know, person who really knows baseball or softball may turn in and listen to the announcers, and the announcers are, you know, maybe not telling it the way that it should be told. You know, like when we mess up, we mess up. You know, we threw it to the wrong base. We should have thrown behind a runner. We should have done certain things in the game in order to educate the public better. I think we can do a better job in, you know, coaching you know, I think we have too much analytics in our game where rather than going with the gut, I learned a long time ago from Jimmy Valvano, basketball coach at Iona when I was there. I said, Jimmy, how do you know when to change from a 1-3-1 to a 1-2-2? I said, he goes, you got to go with your gut. Okay. So I always carried that with me when making a decision, whether to bunt or hit and run or, you know, certain game time decisions. You have to go with your butt. You can't look at a piece of paper and say, well, statistically, I have to do this. And I think that's what's hurting baseball. And I think that if we get into too much of that in softball, I think it could hurt our game. So we have to clear up the illegal pitch. We have to maybe fix the slapping rule a little bit. Even if we have to move the pitcher's mound back a little bit or whatever we have to do so that we don't get so many obstructions, so many illegal pitches, so many delay within the game, and then educate the teams better as to how to play the game within the game rather than just become hitters and ground ball fielders.
Absolutely. Bill, y'all may not know this, but one of my little part-time jobs now is I do color commentary on the computer broadcasted game up at Clemson. And, you know, they've kind of caught lightning in a bottle up there with their softball rollout. I mean, we're talking about a beautiful facility, state-of-the-art, big time, and every ticket for every home game is sold. Now, they don't always all come because of the weather or whatnot, but all tickets are sold. But just this past weekend, I was talking on the air about that the fact that the player made the wrong choice or was not thinking. There was a pause. There's a hesitation. There's, you know, and we've got to talk about that. We've got to be fair. We've got to put it out there. And we are strong enough as a sport now. We're strong enough athletically now that we can talk about those things on the air and not, like you say, not report it in a painted with a rosy brush.
There
comes a time where, hey, they should have went to second with the ball. Or they've got to know what they're going to – they got to know all the what ifs. They got to know the speed of the base runner. They got to know the speed of the batter. They got to know all these little things. And where – because you don't have time to vote in the middle of a play. And we all know that as long as humans play, there's going to be errors. But we also know that the human equation is one of the beautiful things about the sport. I'm so glad to hear somebody is – respected as Bill Edwards talked about the analytics as being too much everywhere, because I do believe that if you get a good coach who is smart and can trust their gut and can teach the game in practice and coach the game on game day, that they can be very, very successful, because the book, quote unquote, the analytics, the chart, quote unquote, they don't know my players personally like I do. They don't know that this person has a sore thumb, or this person is going through something in her family, and it may not be the right time to have her in the lineup and all these things. Or there's just so many things about the human equation. And I really hate seeing sports. I don't want to call it dumbed down, but it's just like there's too much water in it. I mean, it's watered down. And watching
a Major League Baseball game, Scotty, now is like watching a slow pitch softball game.
Yes, it is. Yes, it is. Because everything is called in from the bench. Everything is about hit it as far as you can. You know, and there's a difference between hitting a ball and having an at bat. And that has been taken out of the game. I know, again, this is probably another conversation for another day, but when travel ball, where the players get the highest amount of exposure, became showcases as opposed to actual tournaments, we saw that happen on a huge level because nobody was trying to win a tournament. They were not trying to compete for a victory. They were trying to be sure that their kids are seen, where people, where college coaches will come to their games, where they can get more kids of that kind to come play for them next year, the next year, next year. So the showcase mentality is bled over into college softball because they have not experienced the little things you go through when you're trying to win a dead leg tournament or a conference or a championship. You know, I mean, as long as everybody gets enough at bats to be seen, they go back and go swimming at the pool. If I get beat on game day, you know, I mean, it upsets my routine until I win again. But that's probably another conversation for another day.
We are sophisticated enough now within our sport to tell it the way it is. If we throw it to the wrong base, if we make the wrong decision, okay, why can't we educate the people that need to know that? And why can't we keep the people that already know that in the game and keep them as viewers to sophisticate them even more?
Correct. I agree with you on that. And that all of that ties back into what we've been talking about. If it were not for Title IX and we're not for the pioneers.
Exactly. Yep.
Okay. We wouldn't have ESPN. We wouldn't have television. And we would not have the sport to have evolved to the place it's at. When Bill and I started, this was a much different game than it is now. And luckily, Bill and I were right for our time. Now the time is come and gone, and it's somebody else's time to step up. But we have to understand that The evolution of the game because of Title IX and the good athletes, and then now the recognition that came about during the explosion of the 1990s, we have arrived. Now, everybody's got to find something that they want or need to be better. And yes, there's always going to be programs that don't perhaps try to win as much as other programs do. Because what I mean by that, I don't mean the players, I mean the administration, because money buys horsepower. Commitment to the athletes, commitments to the coaching and the staff and the support staff of programs from a physical level has a direct correlation to how well they do on the field. That is a given. That's been proven. And so, but we have evolved. Where we still have much work to do as a sport, I think we always need to remember exactly how far we have come in the last three decades.
It is amazing how our pioneers, the women that we have mentioned previously, played it up until Title IX. And now Title IX has taken us, along with everything else within our sport, with the leaders of our sport, has taken us to where we are now. And it's been an amazing journey, you know, from the greatest generation to our pioneers, okay, to the transition within our whole society to where now, you know, I would go to my administrators and I would say, the softball field is my learning laboratory. I am a professor of softball. If I am going to be teaching these young ladies, you know, lifetime lessons through life, on a softball field, I need these resources in order to do so. And once you, you know, sort of make them realize what athletics is teaching these young ladies, everything that the classroom can't teach them, then you can maybe make some headway.
Do you think that you talk about the, you know, and we're gonna go off topic, that's okay, because we can, right? We have rules. Do you think that when you listen to the pioneers, it always, they never talk about the team, the coaches of those teams. Like sometimes they talk about the people that put the teams together, but I never hear those individuals talk about the coaches, but I do hear them talk about themselves making coaching decisions. Like Joan Joyce, you know, deciding to put herself in a game to hit when she wasn't pitching one day because she was mad. And I do, you think that we, society speaking, are overcoaching kids? Do you think that comes back to not knowing where to throw to the base and armbands and 10-year-olds wearing pitch sign things? And like, do you think that some of that comes from the overcoaching piece?
Absolutely, because in our game, nobody can tell you what to do. Only the ball can tell you what to do.
That's correct.
We are a reactionary sport, so we don't initiate anything. So since we're not initiating anything, how can we coach anything? We have to teach reaction. If I'm coaching a football team, okay, my best reactionary players are going to go on defense because they have to react to the offense. Well, the only thing that's working is the ball. The ball is telling us what to do. And if we're not coaching the basic fundamentals of the ball telling us what to do, we're going to lose a whole concept of playing defense or offense within our game. And I really think that that's the missing, you know, point of the puzzle. You know, that's one piece that we have to start finding and putting it back into the puzzle, is how to coach the game to that next level. And when you're playing travel ball and you're playing on time limits and nobody cares who wins or loses and you're not competing, you're into a whole nother, you know, world of, okay, we're just going to participate. And, you know, participation, you know, mediocrity is replaceable. So why would we want to just go out there to play for a college scholarship? So now we're playing for a college scholarship rather than playing for the love of the game. The whole pioneers played and carried it to Title IX, where something had to be done with Title IX, because they played for the love of the game. They wanted to be there.
Yeah.
And the Title IX gave them the opportunity to take it to another level, to take it to another step for the next, you know, transition of coaches and players to then cradle it and nurture it and take care of it and make it better. And I'm not so sure at times with some of the, you know, things that you hear about college scholarships and transfer portals and all this other stuff that's going on, I'm not so sure that we're doing a service to the kids that we need to do a service to.
And you're 100% right on that, Coach. And to get back to the original question, I happen to believe the game is overcoached and undertaught. Okay. I believe that if most coaches, particularly in travel ball, had their way, it'd be some kind of little device on the back of every player, and they would sit in the dugout with a joystick where they could just manipulate and move everything. But I got to tell you something. Somebody's throwing a rise ball up there at, let's say, 65 to 70 miles an hour. You don't have time to look down at a wristband to find out what you're supposed to do with that pitch. You got to react. You've got to have already been taught what to do, you see. And that's the thing, the decision-making. This is all through society. Parents, and I'm a parent, grandparents. Oh, I don't want to really talk about grandparents. I'm a grandparent. It's all right for me to spoil my grandchildren. But we make so many decisions for our young people now, thinking that we're making life easier for them, when what we're doing is we're failing to put things in their little survival kit that they need to keep with them all the time. Because adversity does happen in life. Yes, it's in sport, but when we in sport, or when we at these in these formative situations, if we make all the bad stuff go away for our youngsters and never make them understand what's occurring, or in some cases, prevent them from having to take responsibility for something, we're doing them a disservice. So I agree completely with what Bill was saying. He says it much more eloquently than I do, but he's from New York.
Well, yeah, it gets me thinking though, Bill, you talk about Title IX and participation, and that's just it. It wasn't the opportunity to just be able to go practice on a field. You could have done that anywhere, right? I mean, it's an opportunity to compete. It's an opportunity to be seen, you know, and play for a jersey, play for a community, to, you know, win a championship, to, and I think that's a really, and that hasn't come up in any of these conversations yet. And I think that's a really interesting piece because, you know, you might be onto something there, that you get back to the root of it, of why was it important? Why did these women and their parents, and we've heard about a lot of dads and a lot of moms spurring this on, right, for their kids to be able to have this opportunity. But it wasn't just to play in the backyard. It was for something bigger.
I would go to the schoolyard as a kid, and I would play until we couldn't see the ball anymore because it was dark. And then we'd be back at the field again playing. We choose up our own sides, okay? We knew who was playing shortstop. We knew who was batting third. There were no adults around telling us what to do.
Yeah, so we did our own umpiring. We did our own umpiring.
Talk about creating leaders, okay? And the older kids rule the field. Well, you can't choose up sides now in phys ed class because you might be the last one chosen and your feelings are going to be hurt. Well, I tell the story of I'm at the field and I'm in like fourth grade and the sixth graders are choosing up teams. And I'm the last one chosen to get in the game. And I know I'm batting ninth and playing right field. And, you know, but I come off that fence, fist pumping, smiling, happy because I'm in the game. I'm going to play. I couldn't wait to get in the game to play. And if I didn't play well, guess what? I'm not going to be in the next game. So there was pressure, self-inflicted pressure, just at the playground. And then when you left the playground and got to high school, that's where you were really playing for something. You were playing for a league championship, a conference championship, a regional championship, a district championship, a state championship. Can you imagine, okay, being a high school player playing for a state championship? Now, when you have travel ball coaches that are maybe sending a different kind of a message, you know, where we have to expose ourselves. You know, you can't play high school because we have to, you know, get you to play to showcase you because of whatever reasons. Well, flip a coin. I mean, I would much rather be, you know, playing for a state championship. I would much rather be competing for something. I'm playing for a community. It means something to me. And again, you know, we get back to why it's happening because of our pioneers. It's happening because of Title IX. All of these things that are happening within our sport at a very high level. Okay. It's just, you know, you can flip a coin. Okay. And you can say, okay, heads I win, tails I lose. And then you sit back and you go, okay, are we winning this battle or are we losing this battle? And it's just something that you hope we get to sort out and, you know, figure it out sooner or later. And I know, yeah. I ran and I'm sorry, but.
But, you know, to get back to one part of what Bill just said, just wanted to play. And that's what I envisioned that the Joan Joyces of the world did. They just wanted to get in the game. You know, they drove themselves. They washed their own uniforms. They bought their own gloves. They bought their own bats. They had to buy the ball. They just wanted to get in the game. Now they're in the game. And the game has got more attention and more resources being thrown at it than it ever has before. And it's up to us, the coaches and the older people, the grown-ups, to be sure we use that money right. And Coach Edwards brings up a great point. We can sit here and talk about, are we really winning or losing? You know, and how do we fix that? But this discussion is great, and it's something that needs to be talked about and needs to be talked about by serious people. And it also needs to be talked about in a manner that where we can really talk about it and not be sanitized because we're scared that somebody's going to get their feelings hurt. I'm sorry. Anytime you pick a team, somebody's going to be the last person picked. I mean, that's just, I mean, it's the way it is. When you recruit, you don't usually tell a recruit, hey, well, you know, you were the last one I gave a scholarship to. I mean, but, you know, but that person exists. They never know it, but they exist. But they got the opportunity and they were in the game. And so they should be excited about it. I mean, golly, I just, a chance to play with teammates, all of you wearing the same shirt, is one of the greatest honors I ever imagined as a little boy. It was cool to put on your uniform and go play. And back then, we weren't worried about showcases or being seen or doing anything like that. We didn't know what that was. And Joan Joyce didn't know what that was. Those ladies who played in the 50s and the 60s, they didn't know what that was. The ladies that played in the 70s and early 80s, they didn't know what that was. The ladies who played in the late 80s and early 90s, they started to get a taste of it. And now, you know, the taste is gone from, you know, just a little tingle taste till you can't hold it all in at one time now. And so you end up kind of confused as to how to enjoy it.
Athletics was put into the school system to teach all the lessons that the classroom can't teach. Now, are we still doing that? Or have we let outside influences take us away from the educational purposes of what athletics is supposed to do? Whether it's music, whether it's acting, whether it's, you know, fine arts, whatever it is, those extracurricular activities are supposed to, you know, educate the individual and teach the individual things that maybe cannot be taught firsthand in the classroom. And if we lose that within our athletic system, then we're going to have to reevaluate again.
Yeah, it's definitely something that's difficult. And this time of year is always hard for coaches because you're a few weeks away from the end of the season, and it doesn't matter how good you are, someone on your team isn't happy. You know, someone's not playing, someone's parents think they're better than they should be. You know, there's various things. And, you know, so having the support of that full purpose of athletics and what it's for and what you're learning and really taking the hard look at why it exists and what it's for and the purpose, and then applying that to those individual situations, that seems to have gone a little bit awry too. Of, you know, now it is about the feelings and you know, those things, and those things are important because you can still validate the least talented player on your team. You both did that for years. They had a role, they had a purpose, they were involved, they were important. You can still do that, you know, and they probably know that they're the least likely to get in. You know, they're not so far out of tune that they don't know that. But I think our great coaches have a real talent for doing that and having people feel connected, no matter what their role might be and their purpose might be. It's an important one. I think that's crucial. Yeah, Bill.
And I think what you just said is critical, because if in fact you are taking the time to show that individual their role, you're showing that you care for them. And so long as a player knows that you truly care for them, not only as a softball player, but as a student, as an athlete, to help them through, you know, the older people that have already lived their life, they have the wisdom, hopefully, that might be able to help the younger people through some crises that they're going through. So long as the players know that you're there for them other than just winning a softball game, I think that's going to help the issue also.
Absolutely. You're exactly right. I hope that Bill and I haven't sounded like those two old Muppets set up in the balcony and made fun of the on the Muppet Show. Now young people won't even know what we're talking about, but we know what we're talking about. We're just kind of the two old guys sitting on the porch rapping about the way things used to be or way things should be. But we still, I'm not trying to speak for Bill, but I know how he is. We still have great, great feelings and hopes and love for the coaches and players of today. And we just have been around a while and we've seen things, you know, evolve, and we've seen some of the good and we've seen some of the bad, and we just hope everybody stays aware that We still have to drive the boat. The boat will not drive itself. It will not.
And, absolutely. I'm just trying to figure out which one of you is Walter Matthau and which one of you is, was it Jack Lemmon in the Grumpy Old Men? No, I'm just kidding.
Which one? Wait a minute. Which one ended up with Ann Margaret?
Jack Lemmon.
That's who I am.
So tell me, guys, before we wrap up here, and we've hit on so much, but let's go back to where you are now, watching your alums continue to impact this sport in such a great way, watching coaches you've mentored continue to impact the sport, watching the programs that you built continue to have great success. What does that mean to you where you are right now in your career through the lens of Title IX and explosive growth in the sport and elevation? Just wrap up the feelings that you might have. Scott, you want to go first?
I'm just happy that I was allowed to be part of the circus. I am so blessed to have been part of the world of college athletics. It's given me a house, a family, security, and a legacy, and the legacy is a living, breathing one, because as you said, it goes from coach to player, then the player becomes a coach, and then the people that player coached, they become coaches on down and down and down. And so hopefully a little bit of the good that we've done will be around for years and years to come.
Absolutely, no doubt it will be. Bill, how about you?
I just as far as the coaches that are out there now, I had an expression where it was my job to train them and lose them. Because if you're losing them, then you know that you're doing something beneficial to not only that individual, but also the sport. And I think that when I go back and I sit in my stands with my Hofstra alums, and I just had a 40th reunion with some of my high school alums, which is crazy. I look back and I just want them to have picked up maybe one or two things that they learned through athletics or softball or whatever. And I want them to be good mothers. I want them to be good sisters. I want them to be, useful in their profession. I want them to be successful. I want them to hopefully, take all the information that maybe they, learned or gathered under the athletic umbrella, and that they are using it now to become successful people. And that's when you judge your program, is when you look at athletes down the road, 5, 10, 15 years, what are they doing? Are they great in the community? Are they great with charities? Are they donating their time? Are they, adding, curing cancer? All of those things that you want them to do upon graduation or upon playing for you. So that's where I'm at. I want the kids that are going to continue to be in the profession, to coach, to be successful, obviously. And I want those that are out in the professional world to be good professional, good moms, and, just be useful people within our society.
Well, you both have done so many tremendous things for this organization, our sport, your universities. Just thank you so much for being advocates for our athletes and coaches, and just thrilled to have you a part of what we're doing. And thanks for taking the time today to chat with us, take a little stroll down memory lane and look at the future and get a little philosophical all at the same time. I appreciate that.
It was my pleasure.
Totally my pleasure. Enjoyed every minute of it.
Did you really, Bill?
Well, hanging out with you, Scotty, has made my year.
Oh, so, Lord. You need to get a better brand of friend.
I need to do more, right?
Hey, we need to let her go. And I...
great seeing you, my buddy.
Good to see you, bud.
You take
Thanks,
care.
Thanks, guys. And get San Antonio on your calendar, huh? Let's get you both there. That'll be a good time.
Looking forward to it.
Thank you, much.
All right, everybody, if you're looking for more, we have more stories where these came from. Check out all of the video interviews on our NFCA gender equity page. And if there's something you want to know more about, let us know and we'll get these two guys back and we'll talk about whatever you want to talk about. So thank you all very much. Have a great rest of your day. Appreciate it.